Hey, welcome to In the Growth Space. I'm David McGlennon, and I'm your host. You know, it's really great to have you here, so thank you so much for listening in. I really appreciate you being here, and I really appreciate being able to share this episode with you and really being along with you on your growth journey. It means a lot to me, and whatever you're doing right now, if you're working out or if you're driving, whatever. Just thank you for allowing me to enter into this growth space with you. You know, the growth space is a place where we grapple with things, and sometimes those things make us uncomfortable, and sometimes it takes us time to think about and to reprogram our thinking about the things that we deal with in our leadership and in our life and in our life journey. But most importantly, the growth space is about transformation. And transformation is an emotional journey. And so I hope that I can help you on that journey. And I hope that I can help you by having conversations with people who are maybe challenging our thinking, challenging our status quo. Hopefully they're interesting. And I definitely know that they're authentic, because that's really the people that I resonate with. And I've been on my own growth journey for a number of decades. It started with the Nightingale Conant catalog. If any of you listening remember that catalog, there was a catalog that came to the house that had a listing of programs, of usually cassette tapes, and then it migrated to CDs. Programs of self-development, people like Tony Robbins and Dennis Waitley, Zig Ziglar, Norman Vincent Peale, and so many others. And today what I want to do is tell you a little bit about my own growth journey, and maybe even some things that I do to help me grow from the experiences that I have. And so today, it's an episode that I just really want to share with you, maybe that a little bit more of a personal experience. And I wrote a blog post, but I never published it, about this day, about the day that I'm going to tell you about. And I guess the reason why I want to share it is because sometimes we think that growth happens just intellectually. We think we get knowledge and we grow. And while part of that's true, it really takes getting the intellectual knowledge that we have into our heart. And it also takes some reflection time to be able to reflect on the experiences that we have and extract the learning and extract the growth from those experiences. And, you know, my experience is that if we're just growing intellectually, that's really not enough. And I can say for a lot of years, I grew intellectually. I put a lot of things in my mind, but it wasn't until I really started grappling with some issues and challenges that I had in my own life that I really felt like I was growing. And I think it's true with a lot of leaders. I think a lot of leaders, they want to be able to grow and they want things fast. I know I did, and I still do. I like things fast. I like them easier. But life isn't always easy, and life isn't always fast. And I guess I'm learning that the longer I live and walk this planet. So often leaders will ask, you know, hey, what's the latest hack? You hear about these desires to find the hack. You know, what's the shortcut? I want to get there faster. I want to get there easier. And I just have to say that growth isn't easy, and it's rarely fast. Sometimes it can be, but it's rarely fast. It takes time. So I want to share a story with you and an experience from a trip that I took with some great friends, and then some of my lessons that I learned along the way. So the day that I want to tell you about started very, very early. It was basically oh dark o'clock. it was the butt crack of dawn, as some people would say. I had a friend who used to describe this early part of the morning that way. We needed to get an early jump on the day, because that was going to be really crucial for us to make sure that we accomplished the mission that we had that day. And remember, I was with a group of friends, and it was really chilly that morning, and it was dark, and you really couldn't even call it day yet. It was definitely pre-dawn. Our headlamps that we had on helped us to be able to see so that we could get our equipment on and so we could get some breakfast and maybe just a little bit of campfire coffee before we zipped up our tents and got out on our journey. And today's journey was a trek from where we had set up our base camp. We were camping, and that was at about 9,000 feet in elevation. And we were headed to a summit that was a little over 14,000 feet in elevation. And it was a mountain in Colorado. And I personally didn't know what I was in for in that day. I honestly just didn't know what to expect, but I was ready and excited for the adventure. So off we went. And as we started off hiking, we took our time, but we just kept marching on with intention. So we just kept moving towards the summit. And I will tell you that each one of the guys who were on this trip, they were all good friends of mine. And some I had just met that were friends of friends, but we all really enjoyed the adventures that we were going on. And I had this group of guys who we would go on these adventures, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that here in just a moment. But one of the guys who was on this adventure was really my training partner for years. I think if I'm recalling, nearly 20 years. And in front of my camera here, on the other side of this camera, I have a picture, and it's a collage of a number of those different adventures that we've taken. We logged, I don't know, tens of thousands of miles on our bikes together, and hundreds, if not thousands, of miles running, and untold distances swimming. We did triathlons. We were triathlon training buddies. And not only that, Jeff was really one of my best friends, and he still is to this day. We can pick up the phone, and it's just like no time has passed at all since we last saw each other. And the truth of the matter is that this guy, Jeff, is the reason why I stuck with working out and kept myself in shape and really kept my focus on my health for as long as I have. He helped create within me an identity of someone who values health. And I appreciated that so much, to be able to have a buddy, someone who kept me accountable, and kept me sticking with the working out, and kept myself being in shape and valuing my health. But more importantly, I valued the camaraderie. I know that on one of my episodes not long ago, I talked about this epidemic of loneliness and how important it is to be in community with other people. And Jeff certainly provided that with me and for me. And he also just provided the motivation to keep pushing me, and I pushed him towards my best and becoming the best version of myself physically in a physical way. And we trained so long together that we were literally 3 seconds apart in our time on one particular triathlon. I think that I shared this story on another podcast episode, but 3 seconds it seems like not a lot of time, but it was one small thing that made that 3 seconds difference. One small thing, just not wearing socks, helped me to have that 3 second differential. And I've got a picture of it on this collage right in front of me. And I'm reminded of it all the time. But back to the story. And on this day that we were trekking up the side of a mountain, he and I were both past those triathlon training days. And we continued to stay in shape, and we could, we wanted to be able to do these kinds of adventures together. And so we both wanted to take this trip and do this adventure together. because we had a different purpose for this particular trip. This particular trip was really special. And it was special because in those years when we were training for triathlons, we also had another friend who would join us during our training sessions sometimes. And his name was Dr. Dan. And I don't know if I've talked about Dr. Dan a lot on the podcast, but he was a unique guy. He was gregarious. He was, very outgoing and you know, pretty unassuming too, because, and I almost said humble, but I'm not sure I could describe Dr. Dan as humble, because he was confident in his abilities. He was confident in his abilities as a surgeon. And frankly, he was probably, if not the best pediatric orthopedic surgeon in the country. He had great intellect. He had great physical prowess. He was an athletic stud. I mean, he was just amazing. He could run fast. He could run really fast and hardly take a breath. It felt like he was just talking all the time. It drove me crazy because I could never never keep up with him. And to be honest, when we first met, I was really intimidated by him. He was smart. He was athletic. And yet, over time, he became my friend. And I'm so grateful. He was usually the life of the party. And he always kept the conversation going. And there was never a dull moment with Dr. Dan around. I have to just stress that point. He was always so fun to be around. And I was fortunate enough also to have some other great friends and friends of friends that would take these kinds of trips together. Dan would be our tour guide, our Julie. If you remember Julie from the Love Boat, she was the tour director. He was kind of our tour director, so he would plan everything out. And we referred to these trips as free dog trips. And so the idea is that, you know, normally in normal everyday life, the status quo, you're kind of chained to those responsibilities that we all have, right? We all have the responsibilities of a home life. We all have responsibilities of, you know, family, of work, and all of those kinds of status quo obligations. But yet once in a while, just like you train a dog, you take the collar off and you say, free dog. And you let the dog rip, and they can just rip and run and take off and just enjoy themselves. And so these trips, we called them free dog trips. One of the guys had an RV and painted that on a trailer that we would tow with us when we were taking bikes. So it was kind of our opportunity to just kind of run like the wind and frolic and have fun as guys. And these trips also usually had something to do with adrenaline and maybe a little bit of fear and definitely physical exercise. And so those components were always exciting. And on this day, for this journey, though, Dr. Dan was not with us physically. He wanted to take this trip so, so badly a year ago, or a year before this, I should say. And unfortunately, he was battling cancer, and the cancer that was in his body was winning the battle, and he was too weak to go. And so we canceled that trip that year. But Dan was with us in more ways than one on this trip. And so the hike that we were on to the beginning of this climb, It was fairly, you know, fairly easy, fairly innocuous until we got to the switchbacks. So we got to the switchback path, and we could see, you know, as we approached the initial ascent, that we were just going to be switching back and forth, you know, as we got up to kind of the ridge or the saddle of the mountain. And as we began to make our way up, the altitude then forced us to go slower than I thought we would be going, and slower than really probably all of us wanted. But each of the guys on the trip were in really good shape, but altitude really is the the great equalizer. We all had been training at basically sea level, and you know, we're already at 9 or 10,000 feet. So getting too fast of a pace would have us gasping for air. And honestly, the only person that wasn't gasping as much was my son, my oldest son, who was with us. And you know, he had just recently finished his obligation to the U.S. Marine Corps. And so he was in really good shape. But we continued slowly and steadily and just kept climbing and kept walking and kept hiking. And then once we made it to the first ridge, or that saddle of the mountain, we rested a bit and we caught our breath and we just looked back at the where we came from, and then looked on ahead at where we needed to go. We looked at the rest of the climb, and it was going to be a climb. It was going to be climbing over rocks and boulders and little rocks and ledges. And keep in mind, we did not have ropes, so we were basically free climbing. Now, when I say free climbing, if any of you are climbers, we weren't free climbing like, you know, a cliff face. This was bouldering. But nonetheless, the danger was real. And as the ascent progressed, we took our time because we didn't want to fall. We didn't want to make a wrong step and you know, get injured and have to come off the mountain. And each push off of a rock or placement of our foot took precious time. And so it also took energy as we were entering into that thinner air. If any of you have been at altitude, you know what I'm talking about. You know, that 9, 10, 11,000 feet, 12,000 feet, it makes a big difference. And so we climbed and we bouldered. But as we got to the summit, we took a look at our clocks, and man, it had taken 5 hours from the time that we started at like 4 o'clock in the morning to the time that we got to the summit. And I never thought that it was going to take that much time. I couldn't believe that much time had passed. And I really never, I don't think, knew like what to expect or what, how much time to, you know, to account for. I guess I thought that, you know, maybe it was just going to be like a 2 hour climb and back down and, you know, be back for brunch. But I was sadly wrong. But I will say that once we got to the summit, the view from the summit was absolutely magnificent. I'm not sure I have the words that I can describe what it looked like, but I can picture it in my mind's eye. And one of the things that we did, yes, we took some pictures, but most of the time we were absorbing everything that we could in our mind and just feeling the experience. We took in what it felt like. We took in what it smelled like. We took in what it looked and sounded like. And we even, at one point, were looking down upon a rainbow. You know, in all my years of flying airplanes, I had never done that before. Even though, you know, I was at pretty high altitude, I had never looked down at a rainbow. But it was really a special, special day. And I think one of the special things for me was having my oldest son with me as well. And just to be able to share in the specialness of that moment, I don't think it would have been as special without him. It would have been, just another climb or, another adventure. But as we looked down upon that rainbow, we also saw in the distance the peak of another mountain. And that beauty just surrounded us. And so we took that all in. And before we began the descent, and one of the reasons why we needed to kind of not take too much time up there was because, honestly, it started to snow. It does snow in August at 14,000 feet. So we knew that we needed to begin the descent, but we had one piece of business that we needed to attend to. And because Dr. Dan had wanted to go on this trip with us, we made sure that we took a part of him with us, not just in our hearts, although he was surely there. My friend Jeff pulled out a container that he opened, and you know, we had a moment of silence, and that silence was filled with wind and then the beginning of some snow. And then we just scattered Dan's ashes in the growing wind so that a part of Dan could be always on that mountain that he wanted to go to so badly. We snapped some pictures, and we took in the last moments of the scene, and then we started down the day, or down the mountain. And I have to say, what a sight, what a day, what an experience. And, you know, as it started to spit some snow, we had to be really careful going down the mountain. And, you know, Dr. Dan always used to say, hey, it doesn't have to be fun to be fun. And so we definitely embraced the suck going down too, because we had to take our time. It was the rocks were getting slippery. And so there were so many reasons why this day sticks out in my memory. And I'm going to share some things here in a moment, some of my learnings and some of my lessons that I learned on the journey, because it takes evaluated experience to really grow and to really capture lessons that we all learn from our experiences. Because if you don't evaluate your experiences, you're just going to have them as a memory and then you're going to move on. I like to take some time and reflect on the experiences that I have, especially ones that are cemented in my mind so much, like this story, like this event in my mind. One of the best lessons that I learned that day is that, you know, we really never know what lies ahead. But if we're excited for the adventure, and if we have a big enough why, we'll find a way. We'll find the energy that it takes to reach our goals, to reach our objectives. And heck, it'll even help us to do the things that scare us and do things that get us outside of our comfort zone. And so even though you may not necessarily know what's in front of you, I want to encourage you to tap into your why. Tap into the reason why you're doing what you're doing, the reason why you're going after the goal, reason why you are going through and towards the objective that you're going towards. Be willing to commit and tap into the reason that you're doing it. And when you do that, then you will be able to summon the energy to get to where you need to go. Now, along with that, the other thing that I learned is that most goals take a lot longer and they demand a heck of a lot more from us than we originally expected. And so be ready to go in for the long haul. Go in for the long haul and be ready to endure. Be ready to be persistent and endure pain if you need to. Endure expending a lot of energy, because it's going to take sometimes everything you have to be able to get to the goal that you've set. Sometimes it's going to take switchbacks. It's going to take, you know, going back and forth, making little progress. It's never a straight line. It is never a straight line. And that's what adds to, I think, the beauty of achieving the goal, because even though we're making little progress in those switchbacks, we are still making progress. And I would say too that just be prepared to sweat. Put some sweat into achieving your goals. Be prepared to finding a way when the road gets tough and when you can't hardly breathe. Make sure that you find a way. And sometimes that means resting. That means resting at a certain spot to be able to make it to the rest of the way. So be committed and find a way when maybe there might be an obstacle in front of you. So another lesson that I learned is that I need people. I need people to help me to get to my goals. There is absolutely no way that I would have gotten to the top of this mountain without the guys that were around me. both from a motivational perspective. And then also there was one guy with us who is an experienced mountaineer. He was able to find the path to be able to take us up the mountain. And the same thing is true in our life and in our leadership. We need others, especially in a world where things are changing faster than we can keep up with. We need others, and we need to be able to be around others so that we can see things that we don't see, and we can get the motivation that we need and the encouragement and the support that we need to be able to keep going and achieve the objectives that we've set for ourselves and that we've set with each other. I honestly would not have made it off that mountain safely had I not had each of those guys there. They were much more experienced than I was, and they really even helped me to lean into my discomfort zone quite literally, because as we were up on some of these ridges that were very, very narrow, and you're looking down at what would be certain death, if not very, very painful fall, it's easy to be able to want to lean in towards the mountain and lean in towards something that's more stable. But what I found out was, is that when I did that, my center of gravity shifted on my shoes and actually would allow me to slip more easily. So I had to stand upright and even be a little bit more uncomfortable, feeling like I was closer to that edge. So make sure that you surround yourself with people that will help you, that will support you, that will encourage you, and that will take you along with them and yourself to the goals that you are setting. Now, not only did I need other people on this journey, but honestly, had I not had them, it would not have been as fun as well. So having a group of people around you, having a team that's fun, the people that you enjoy being challenged by, and that you enjoy going on a journey with, man, that's so important. It's so important because when we set goals not to necessarily achieve the goal. While yes, we want to achieve the goal, but we want to become the person that can achieve the goal. And that takes people around us that are fun to be with, that will challenge us, that will help us, that will support us. And moving towards our goal needs these kinds of people. And we need those kind of people to help us achieve the goals that we're setting for ourselves. The other thing that I learned is there's so much value in being out in nature. If you're out walking right now, if you're hiking, if you're maybe exercising, man, get outside if you're not outside. Being outside, nature is always such a great teacher. I've learned so much from being outside and being in the woods and being in nature, and this trip is no exception. You know, being in a place where we didn't have internet, we didn't have connectivity, it helped us to disconnect, and you'll be more inclined to just take it all in when you're not connected. So get out into nature. Nature is such a great teacher. And when you're in nature, be sure to take it all in. You know, I can still, to this day, I know what it sounds like at our base camp. I could hear the rushing water coming out of the glacial lake that was emptying into this creek. I could smell the pine trees that we were camping in. I could visually see the last remnants of snow on the side of a mountain. I experienced it in a visceral way. And I think that that's the beauty of nature. That's the thing that nature does. Nature can teach us so much about everything in life, seasons, seasonalities, being in the moment, and even just gratitude. Man, nature is such a great teacher. So I just want to encourage you, get out into nature more. So just in summary, some of the things that I learned from this trip, from this day, is that, getting to the top, it's going to take everything that you got. Getting to your goal is going to take everything that you have and then some. And it's also going to take a team of people around you. It's going to take a group of people to help you, an inner circle, as it were. Making it to the summit and really achieving your goals, you're going to want to take other people with you, and you're going to make sure, you're going to have to make sure that the people you pick are ones that can push you onward and help spur you on when you need it the most. And honestly, it's all about becoming someone new. Being in that growth space, being in that place where you've never been before, is about becoming someone new. I know that I'm different because of this day. I am someone different because of this adventure, because of this experience in my life. Being able to be with guys that I love, being able to be in nature that I love, being able to accomplish something that was meaningful and was difficult and challenging, man, that changed me. And so it you know, being in the growth space, it's all about becoming the next best version of yourself, the next best you. So keep challenging yourself. And really, that's what growth is all about. That's what the growth space is all about. And the other thing I would say too, last thing maybe just on this topic, is that do things that you've never done before. Do things that will get you outside of your comfort zone and get you into that growth space. And that applies both personally and professionally. If you're in a job that you need some challenge, and there's a role in your organization, there's a challenge that maybe lays ahead, go for it. Go for it and do something that you've never done before. So let me ask you, what's something that you've never done before? Maybe what's a day that you're never going to forget? So maybe something is cemented in your mind. What did you learn? What did you learn from that day? What did you learn from that experience? And probably more importantly, how could you create more experiences, more moments like that? I'd love to hear from you. I would love to hear your comments about a day that you'll never forget and some of the lessons that you've learned in your own growth space. Thank you so much for listening in today. I hope that this serves you well. I hope that this story from my own growth journey encourages you, and I hope that it spurs you on to the next best version of yourself. I honestly never take for granted that you're listening in to this podcast and I'm in your ears. I'm in your earbuds likely, or maybe playing on your radio, your speakers in your car. Thank you. Thank you so much. Please do me one quick favor before you go. If you wouldn't mind, go on your podcast app, give us a rating, give us a review. And then I would also appreciate it if you shared the podcast. Just share it with one person or two people that you feel like this would encourage and maybe support as well. Thank you so much again. I appreciate you. And until the next time, be well.